flying privileges. As a spouse, I could fly with, I had flying privileges.
Was that for both flights?
No.
Just the one to...
Just the Pittsburgh.
Just the one to Pittsburgh, okay.
Yeah.
So you head down there. Check in the hotel, then you go stay with Dad for a couple of things. At what point does this start setting in? This is really interesting. By now you know what happened. You know what you did. It's all coming together.
Yeah.
What's going on down in Brazil?
Well, I tried to... I wanted to kill myself. I had the fixation. I wanted to kill myself. So when my father told me those words, they moved me a lot. And I want to enjoy that a little bit more. I want to prolong my time with my family as much as I could. So I was saying a long goodbye to them. So I spent those, I don't know, couple 4 days with my father, 3-4 days. And he said, I talked to your siblings and they think it's better that you don't stay here with me, you go to Brasilia, because there are more people there to cheer you up. Here's just me and you. You're too sad, you don't talk, you don't eat, you don't do anything. So I think there's a better environment for you. But I have no woman. He said, don't worry about it, we already got you a ticket. So I went to Brasilia and I had an apartment there, and that my sister lived in, and I just stayed with my sister. She had kids and more people. And
did everybody down there know who you were, what was going on up here? Did they know about what happened?
My whole family, yeah. And they took care of me.
What about the people of Brazil? I mean, did you just blend in down there and nobody really knew what was going on or who you were?
No. That didn't hit the news in there for, I think, a year or two. Yeah. So so they just cheered me up. They tried to cheer me up because nothing with the... And then I tried the same thing that I did in the hotel in Rio. I did in Brasilia 4 times. I went to the... To another hotel. I went to the 13th floor and I tried the same thing, but for some reason things would not work out.
What were you going to do? You were trying to jump?
Jump, yeah. So I spent all the money that I had going to those hotels to try to kill myself. So I figured out that it would be very hard. To kill myself that way. I just didn't have the courage to do that. I would find excuses. I would wait too long, and things just didn't work out. And I was running out of money. I said, I don't have any more money to keep going to hotels. And I had a little piece of land that I had from many years before, from 20 years before I went back to Brazil. But there was no construction there. So that $10,000 that I gave to my father would gave me all back to me, and I was living off of that money. But I was spending it all, and I was spending it like water because I thought, I don't need money. I'm going to kill myself. Why do I need money? I'm going to expensive hotels to try to kill myself. And then I bought, I was running out of money, but I think it still had four. I had 1,000 left. I spent all the money real quick, and I bought some wood and some bricks and to build a little shack. And I bought a little Beetle, Volkswagen Beetle, because I thought another way to commit suicide was through the exhaust of the car. So I figured I would get the car in that room, and I would get it running, and I would take some sleeping pills, and I would die from the
carbon monoxide.
Yes, carbon monoxide. But then had a problem because when the beetle was inside that little shack, he made so much noise.
You couldn't fall asleep?
No, the neighbors. The neighbors would hear that noise and go there and try to find out what was going on. So I figured that I would have to wait until some festivity day, carnival, some day that would have a lot of music going on for me to do that. So as I kept postponing, I was getting better, stronger psychologically, and I met my husband there. And
you got married again down there?
I did.
Yeah, so we really get to hear about it when you're ready.
I've been married for 11 years.
Really?
Yeah.
So from the time you got down there, you basically got married right away?
Yeah, to a guy that worked in the construction store that helped me build the shack. He was uneducated man, a very...
You kind of said he was like a farmer.
Farmer.
Let me ask you a question. When did you get married? Do you remember what your wedding day was?
Well, there is two types of wedding, the official and the non-official.
Okay.
We got into a relationship.
Right.
In 2007, like around June.
So 3 months after being down there.
No, we started talking. Right. 6 months later, we firmed up. We were flirting.
Did you know him before you went to Brazil this time? Is this somebody you knew from your past in Brazil?
No.
You met him when you got there?
The construction was the first time I saw
him. Did he know what happened up here?
No, I told him a story.
That would probably be a deal breaker, I would imagine.
Yeah, exactly. So I was afraid of telling the story, so I told him that I was from Rio de Janeiro, that was there hiding from my husband, that was a police officer, that I didn't want to be married to him anymore, and he swore me to death, and I had to hide. Nobody could know where I was. That's why I was hiding in the middle of nowhere. Building a shack in the middle of nowhere, so my husband that wanted to kill me wouldn't find me. But after he built that little shack, I had some articles, newspaper articles, and some pictures of Carl in a box in that shack. And because he took care of that shack, he saw those papers, and he figured out that my story was not exactly the way I said. He confronted me, and I said, look, it's better that you don't ask too many questions. You know enough, because maybe that's not entirely the truth, but if I tell you the truth, you're probably not gonna want to talk to me anymore and start crying. He said, try me out. Surprised, something like that. I figured that I knew that my story wasn't true, and I took a chance. So I told him the whole thing. I said, look, if you want to leave and never talk to me again, go right ahead. I will understand. He said, no, I like you more now that you told me the truth. Before.
And you're still with him now. That's who you wanted. That's who you wanted, Sean, to call to get your property and stuff.
Yeah.
Right. That's who we called to get your stuff.
Let's go over here. Mm-hmm.
That's good too.
Yeah. Something I like to talk. And what we'll do is we'll take one more little break before we're done, just to make sure there's nothing. We've sat here with you for quite some time. This is probably the longest interview I've ever done.
Yeah. But you're missing a very important part.
We're not. Listen. We'll listen to you all night. I'm not worried about it. But I like to ask two things. First of all, if you could, remember we talked about earlier if the Hoerig family was going to be able to hear this or see this,
because if I say more about his character, I'm afraid that it's going to hurt them too much.
We'll give you the chance to say whatever you want. Just like we said from the start, this is your story, okay? You're the artist here. You paint the baby.
It's not because it was only a fetus that has no value. And what hurts me more, and that's the talk about here, is because I was getting into the part that he was depressed, and I want to get him treatment in Brazil because a pilot with mental problems forced into retirement. You can be a pilot. You know that. You know about the story of the pilot, German pilot, that
right.
You know, when they are playing with 200 people against the mountains because he had depression, untreated depression. So he knew that he had any situation of going to a psychiatrist. He would have to stop playing. So my plan is, I was being his therapist, I was talking to him, getting him to cheer up, and at the same time, trying to get him medicine in Brazil, sneak up medicine, you know, go to Brazil, not sneak up medicine because you're allowed to bring him medicine, but so he would take medicine without, off the records, without anybody knowing that he was taking psychiatric medication.
Did he take these medicines?
No, I wasn't able to get the medicine from Brazil. I only talked to my father about that. I spoke to my father about getting the medication, but I didn't fly to Brazil to get the medication. I was deciding that with Carl. So at one point I had to tell his parents what was going on, that he was very depressed. So I talked to his parents and we were figuring out a plan to help Carl. But at one point Steve, he didn't like that. He figured that I shouldn't be involving his parents in my marital problems. So things were, I was getting the support I needed because I was alone helping a sick man. It was too much for me. That was getting me mentally sick.
And where's this fall in the time frame of things?
That was the last 4 months. The last 4 months. So I was talking to his parents. They were being very supportive, and they were very concerned about him. So then Steve got into the picture, and he said, "Don't you ever talk to my parents about your marital problems. Do not ever involve my parents in your marital problems." So that was when I was alone with a big problem. I saw a light at the end of the tunnel with the parents. But one said, "Don't solve your own problems." Then I was alone again. Then I became very ill because his parents were encouraging me to not take the abuse. Yes, you can wear sneakers. Yes, you can wear closed shoes.
So his parents even started siding with you at some point.
Yes, yes. That's your own fault because you take the abuse, because he doesn't let you wear jackets in the house. You can't put up with that. So they start encouraging me to stand up for myself. But once they got out of the picture, I didn't feel strong enough to stand up for Carl, you know. So I said, now I'm in trouble again. He's starting to dominate me, and I was hurting again, and became very depressed. And sleeping pills, took sleeping pills, and I took the car, and I fell into a pit. I fell with the car into a pit, and then they took me to a hospital. I was unconscious. They saved me, and they're gonna release me the next day. Mm-hmm. They're gonna release me, and they called in the nurse, and they said, "Mr. Hoerig, do you think your wife is ready to go to the house?" And then he hesitated a little, and I had told him about. That's the day when I told him about the gun. He didn't know about the gun yet. I told him before the sleeping pills, I had tried to kill myself with your gun. Then he said, "Oh my God," he got really nervous. Then he told the nurse, "I think she should stay at the hospital a couple more days to see if she's really good." And the nurse wanted to know why. And he told the nurse about the gun, and then they committed me to a mental hospital, and I stayed there a few weeks. And I said, "If you do that, if you don't tell that nurse, I can go home. You know that all I have is my job. It was tax season. All I have is my job. It was like January. I'm gonna lose my job." I was in the middle of doing an audit for the Salvation Army. And I said, "I'm almost done with the order. Nobody can pick up from my laptop. And I'm going to hurt that company, that firm, and I'm going to hurt myself professionally. You know that I love to work. All I do is work. I work 7 days a week, and I work 14 hours a day. You know that I love to work. If you take that away from me, taking everything away from me, please don't do that." Really sorry. He went to the hospital every day, said how much he was sorry, how much he loved me, but I was really angry at what he had done to me. And and the psychiatrist, every day we had to meet with the psychiatrist, and I started telling to the psychiatrist that I wasn't crazy. He was the crazy person. He should be there, not me. And then they thought I was really crazy. Crazy person says that the other person is crazy, that they are normal. Things got worse to me. Then they would leave me at the hospital. Then I got smart. I said, "This doctor is crazy. He was crazy." I said, "I gotta be smarter than him." Then I changed everything around. I said, "No, doctor, you're really right. I'm crazy. You're right. I'm crazy. My husband, he's wonderful, has done nothing wrong to me. I'm the bad person. Now I see everything clear. I'm crazy. Yes, I should be here, but I feel so much better. You can let me go home." But that didn't work so fast. Didn't work so fast. He said to see what was consistent in saying that I was the crazy one, but I was feeling better. And that worked. So then he released me. I went back to work, but that day, I'm sorry. And then really, really depressed. He was really, really, he was happy to have me home, because he would play his game. He took a few days off work to be with me.
He didn't want you working anywhere.
No, he didn't want me working.
He didn't want you working, did he?
No, he did. He liked my money. Yeah, but not to live here, but get a job eventually. You know? He never gave me any money.
Let me ask you, one thing I didn't ask you. After you shoot, and you get your wits about you, and you realize what just happened, did you ever think about just calling the police?
Yes, I did, and I was. But my father said, not because of the death penalty.
Your dad was protecting his daughter.
Yeah, I didn't care.
How long after you shot him? All these conversations between your dad, your sister, your sister's husband. How long are you in that house?
But then my idea, no, that wasn't, my father knew about the death penalty. He told me, I didn't know anything about the death penalty.
You know what, earlier when you were talking, you said that, you know, you would talk to your father, you talk to the pastor, you talk to your sister, and you said there was an attorney. Did you talk to the attorney one of your family?
No, I don't even know who this attorney was. The only thing I know is that I heard somebody, either my father, my sister, they were talking to an attorney. I could hear in the background.
Somebody else was talking to somebody in the background.
Yeah, okay. Calling an attorney. Okay. You know, I don't know who this attorney was. I've never seen him.
Let me ask you this, Chris. What do you think? Now, you've had almost 11 years to think about this. Now that you're here and the day has come, what do you think should happen to you? What do you think your punishment should be?
Okay. It doesn't matter to me. My life is over since that day. It doesn't matter. I'm already dead inside. If you say you're free to go, I still don't have a life. If you say you're free to go, where? Go back to Brazil? I don't respect that country anymore. I probably would go back to Brazil because of my health. But inside, I'm dead. To me, it doesn't matter where I am, man. I live for people. I live for animals. I'm an animal protector. I take care of sick animals, dogs, cats, horses, whatever I find that is sick. That's my life mission, to take care of other people. I feel like I'm taking care of my husband because he's a man that has health problems. He cannot work. So I feel like I'm taking care of him, like I'm taking care of the animals. So as long as I feel like I'm helpful to somebody, well, that I have a reason to live. But not for me. I don't care if I'm in prison here, in prison in Brazil, if I'm alive, if I'm dead. I'm dead inside. I've been dead since March 12, 2007. It doesn't matter to me.
That's strong. Very strong. Do you feel somewhat better now that you're here and this next chapter is going to start?
I do because it's closure for me.
Yeah, we talked about this a lot on the plane.
And something that'll make you feel better is this is probably the last step of closure for his family. Because I know you said you care about his family and you care about what they think.
Yeah.
So this is very important to them as well.
I just don't care for Steve. Because Steve, I don't like Steve because Steve is the reason why this whole I would be married to the state. So I don't like Steve. Steve, he wasn't, you know, he didn't do the right thing for his brother. He did a very bad thing. I don't like Steve. I like Paul. I like his mother, his father. I like Eve, his daughter. I like Brent, his son. I don't like Steve. Steve was bad. Not intentionally. I understand that was not intentional. But he was impulsive. He did very big harm. So Steve, I had resentment towards Steve.
Here's what we're going to do right now. We're going to take one more little break. Okay? And while we're gone, I want you to think about things that maybe you feel. We've sat here listening to work for the next couple of minutes. Think about that, and when we come back in, you're going to have your chance to tell us that stuff. Alright? And we're going to go talk about, hey, is there anything else we need to talk to her? Okay?
Yes, sure.
Alright, first, that all makes sense.
Do you need anything else? Any water, any more tissues, anything like that?
No, I'm good.
Okay. We'll break the time is 12:09.
Okay.
We'll be right back, okay?
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to take my pen.
Yeah. But I'm going to do harm to myself.
Yeah, I don't want you to do that. Don't do that here, okay?
I won't do that. Don't worry about it.
Remember, you said you wouldn't do that as long as you're helping people, and you've been very helpful to us.
I don't want to go to hell.
back on.
That's a piece of wood?
Yeah. We're back on and it's 12. I brought this thing in, just so you knew, for 11 years. We have our ideas and we have our thoughts.
Which is the thing?
We'll tell you. Well, we thought a few different things. We thought about the suicide thing, just not in the same manner. Just not in the same manner you did.
Oh.
Maybe leaning over it or something like that.
Leaning over?
Yeah, the way it was, it was just something that came to our mind. And we also thought maybe it was a booby trap, but somebody opened a door. Could there have been something tied to the trigger to make, you know, thought of a few different things.
To shoot one of us. We thought maybe it was booby trap, so if you opened the door, whoever opened the door would get shot.
But
whether it was
no
Carl
restraints.
Or whether it was us.
Well,
or
right. We couldn't figure
we couldn't
out.
Figure it out. They just didn't. They just. It was.
But you didn't see the seat.
You gotta remember, I'm getting old now. My memory's not what it used to be. So I can't really say. I don't know.
You don't have pictures.
I'm not sure.
Double?
Yeah, but I didn't know you were coming. Okay.
This is the bottle of cachaça on the bed.
Well, believe me, we'll be going through this case with a fine-tooth comb now, trust me. One other, I guess probably the simplest question that we didn't ask. Instead of killing him, wouldn't it have been easier to just get a divorce?
I tried, he wouldn't let me.
How far did you go? I mean, would you... You tell him, you told him you wanted a divorce?
Almost every day.
And what was his story? What was his answer?
I love you. I beg you, won't change. I love you. I love you. I can live with you, most beautiful woman in the world. I love you. I swear I'm going to change. What wife won't accept a man asking for forgiveness? I hadn't tried long enough, only 2 years.
Well, and then
it's not like I had tried the 10 years. Oh, I already put up with you 10 years. It's not going to work. It had been only 2 years. So, you know, I had to try a little bit more.
So you made this thing yourself?
Yeah.
What did you use to make a little hole? Remember?
I had many tools, many tools.
You're pretty handy.
I build houses, I paint houses, I do more stuff. Very handy.
Did you just put the end of the gun on there and kind of trace it and then figure out a way to cut it out?
Yeah.
Not a bad job.
Mm-hmm.
Chris, well, is there anything else that you want to say, that you want to get off your chest, that you think we should know, that you want to talk to us about? Anything else, now's the chance.
There's so many things, but let's see.
Well, here's what I can tell you. Here's what you can expect from this point forward, okay? At some point, obviously, you're going to go into our jail tonight, and at some point, maybe as early as tomorrow, you're going to see a judge.
Really? For what?
For your murder charge.
What they'll do is you have a charge, but then they will bring you to court, and it's a lot different than Brazil. They're going to take you to court in front of the judge. The charge will be read to you in court. You'll be told what your rights are, some more rights, the opportunity to get an attorney. So you'll have to go over to court to do that. They'll walk you over to court for that.
Now, if by tomorrow morning, once you get an attorney, like we talked earlier, once you get an attorney, then I can't come talk to you. If tomorrow morning, when you wake up, if you want to talk to me, you just ask one of the officers working in there, and I'll come see you. Okay, if there's something else that maybe we forgot tonight, but really, once you have an attorney, then me and you aren't going to be able to talk anymore.
Oh,
okay?
That's the rules.
Then what will happen is it'll be your attorney talking to our attorneys. That's how that works. Okay? But I'm going to be honest with you. I'm glad this day came. I never thought in a million years this day would come.
Yeah.
All right? But you know what I've learned in the last 3-4 hours? I've learned that this has brought you some closure, it's going to bring his family some closure, and it's going to bring us some closure. So I'm glad that this happened this way in the end. I appreciate your honesty. I appreciate you talking to us.
Thank you. makes a difference to me.
I think we talk about that. It's important for you. It's important for the family. It's important for us. I think you wanted to tell your story, and you got the opportunity to do that.
Your story needed to be heard.
There were many things that we didn't know that now we do, mm-hmm. and that's very important.
Yeah, for you to understand this man better, you have to know that he was a subscriber to that site, Hog Tide. That's what he did to me. And he forced me to watch show that I hated. It's called Miles High. That is about couple swinging, pilots with the crew. Men with men, women with women, and that whole dirty thing. And he forced me to watch another TV show called Big Love. Big Love is a man with several wives, and he didn't want me to accept him to have a second wife to live with us. Not a wife, but a maid from Brazil. Spice up our sex life. And he gave me an ultimatum and said, if you don't do that, our marriage is not going to work. So, you know, all those things were very disturbing to me. He wanted me to be a person, to have the sexual behavior that just didn't agree with me.
I understand. I appreciate you, like you said, being honest and talking to us about that. I'm sure it's hard for you to talk
about. Yeah, to have another woman as his wife and accept him to be with men, women, everything. And that, I couldn't do that. What happened? I didn't leave him, but I didn't say yes to him. So that frustrated him and caused a lot of friction between us. You know? So our marriage wasn't smooth because he wanted to turn me into a geisha, into a very passive woman that didn't talk, didn't have an opinion, had many different rules. That I couldn't talk, didn't have an opinion, I couldn't watch, I could only watch the TV shows that he wanted. I couldn't go to sleep, no. I had to stay up with him until the time he wanted to turn off the TV, even though he knew that I had to work the next day. So, you know, that was killing me, you know. So the days that he was at home, I had to stay up until 3 o'clock in the morning, but I had to be up at 5 o'clock in the morning to go to work the next day.
Right.
So that's when I started getting fat, and things got worse progressively because he wanted to control my thoughts, every thought of mine, every move of mine, the clothes that I wore. I had to wear only what he picked for me, and I had to sleep naked, no socks, no pajamas, no underwear, no nothing, and walk around. That's degrading, to walk around naked in the house with high heels. That's insane. That's degrading. So that's the kind of stuff I went through, and other few things that. There are a few things that I don't feel comfortable talking about.
Okay, that's fine. We understand that. I think that you've done a very good job
of
filling in a lot of blanks and making sure that we had,
Yeah, he was a weird man. Sexually, he was weird, and also he was suffering depression.
stop things now. It's 12:24 a.m. It's now the 18th of January, Thursday. And again, you made the statement on your own free will, right?
Yes, I did.
We told you that you didn't have to talk to us, and you chose to talk to us?
Yes.
And we went over your constitutional rights under Miranda with you, which you understood, signed, and waived, right?
Yes.
Chris, I really appreciate it.
Just sit
tight. It's going to help you in anything.
It's going to help everybody.
Here's what I'm going to tell you. I mean, from a police standpoint, I don't like seeing cases that aren't done.
It's just bothering.
Yeah, I mean, little things like this.
You talked about that, didn't you? Things that are unfinished bother you. They bother us, too.
Yeah.
Finding
yeah.
the truth. Filling in the blanks. Now we understand.
I told you, this thing wasn't far away. I told you earlier.
Somebody,
I've thought about this piece of wood a lot.
Didn't figure out
the suicide. Well, we had our ideas. That wasn't one of them. Not that way.
Yeah. I tried to think about that second gun. And I was thinking maybe if the trigger was easier to pull. I don't quite remember the reason I want that second gun.
In the grand scheme of things, it's not that important, but just something that
Knew
about and we wanted
something
to ask.
Something that I was off my mind completely, but because you brought that up, I'm asking myself. It's not going to change anything. But I'm forcing myself to try to remember the reason, and I was thinking that had something to do with the trigger being easier to pull. Because I did this after I wanted to buy the second gun. After. So I think that when I did that I found that way that I could put a trigger, then I didn't need the second gun anymore. Because this would solve the problem.
Do the trick.
Yeah.
Okay. All right, great. We're gonna stop it. The time is 12:26. Just hang on here. We'll be back to get you, okay? Just you need anything?
No.
Okay. We'll be right back. Chris, come on. Grab your glasses. I can wear those. I'm going to put these on, but I'm going to put them on in front of you. Okay?